Thank you for joining us again today, and we're continuing on our topic of Bible morality, banned by wimps, and born and carried by warriors. Many weak and cowardly Americans want to make it illegal. They're afraid of the anti-Bible morality bullies that are attacking the Bible, Jesus Christ, and the morals of the Bible. They forget that Congress, First Amendment, shall make no law respecting an establishment of a religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. And when Congress and the Supreme Court took the Bible out of the schools and prayer out of the schools, which our Congress back in the 1700s passed out 10,000 Bibles to our soldiers and passed a resolution to have the Bible printed in America so the residents of America could have it, we forget that the Bible was the book our nation was established on, not the Quran, not Confucius, not Hindu, it was the Bible. Okay? And we've got to stand up. Now, today we're going to look at what's after the remission of sins. Okay? The remission of sins, Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So the next thing on God's agenda is that you have His Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you, to your children, and to all afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. So it's not just some baptism of the Holy Ghost that stopped somewhere when the apostles died. The promise is to you, to your children, and those afar off. And this is the first of many promises that God gives us after the remission of sins. In 2 Peter 1:4, exceedingly great and precious promises have been given to us by the knowledge and through the knowledge of Jesus Christ. In Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 11, preceding Acts 2, where redemption of sin Peter talked about, they had just initially experienced the baptism of the Holy Ghost, with them hearing a mighty wind from heaven, with them seeing tongues of fire, with them speaking in 15 different languages, with them speaking about the mighty works of God. Peter stood up and spoke the scriptures that stirred the hearts of the people. 3,000 believed, repented, confessed their sins, got baptized, were added to the church, and they united together. And they were visited while they were praying. Now, other initial infillings of the Holy Ghost. John the Baptist, he did no miracles, no healings, but he had the living word and he got filled from the mother's womb. Jesus got it when he was baptized in water. He was led into the desert and there for 40 days and 40 nights. And he had the living word. He had miracles and he had healings. Acts 4, the place was shaken. They were in unity. They spoke the word of God with confidence. They had power to witness for Christ, and it came while they were praying. Acts 8, they were just filled, nothing else recorded, and it was by laying on of hands. Acts 10, they spoke in tongues, they praised God. There was no interpretation here, and they got it while the word was being preached. Acts 19, tongues and prophecy without interpretation, and they got it by the laying on of hands. These are the initial experiences in the Bible about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, what is the purpose of being baptized, being filled with the Holy Spirit? John 16, 8. He, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, will convince the world of sin, of righteousness, and of the judgment to come. He will guide you into all truth, and he won't speak of himself. And he will glorify and testify of me. Too many people are lifting up pastors and ministers, and ministers are lifting up themselves, but the Holy Spirit only lifts up Jesus and His Word. Acts 1:8, you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost shall come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. So what is this power of the Holy Ghost? The power of the Holy Ghost is you shall be my witness. A witness is somebody that experienced something and can give the details of that experience. You see, we know that the apostles did no miracles before. I mean, they did miracles before they were filled with the Holy Ghost. So miracles and the baptism of the Holy Ghost, you know, they're separate. Luke 12:11, when they bring you, not if they bring you, but when they bring you to the synagogues, the religious leaders and the magistrates, the civil authorities, do not worry about what you will answer or say, for the Holy Ghost will teach you in the same hour what you ought to say. So here we see the effect on the tongue. We see the effect on the motion, the worry, the mind. The Holy Ghost comes and you got peace and you got something to say when you need to say it. Yes. How many would like that? Yeah. And so we see that is the power of the Holy Ghost. The example of the power and the witness of Jesus is found in Acts 6:9. These men argued with Stephen, but they could not resist his wisdom or the spirit by which he spoke. Here, Stephen is speaking the word of God by the Spirit, by the Holy Ghost. Not human intellect, but by the Holy Spirit. In Acts 7:54, these people he was speaking to got mad. They got angry. But Stephen, being full of the Holy Ghost, just like he said, when you stand before people, he'll give you something to say. He said, I see Jesus standing at God's right hand. So his eyes were open. It affected his eyes. It affected his mouth, just like in the Acts 2. It affected every part of their being. They cried out even the more and stopped their ears and cast him out of the city and stoned him. And Stephen, kneeling down, cried, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. You see, the power of the Holy Ghost is to be a witness. He could teach them from the Word of God. And then when they got mad at him, he didn't get mad back. He stayed in control and forgave them. That's power. Now, in Isaiah 11:2, we find that there are a list of seven spirits of God. In Revelation 5:6, it backs this up saying, in the midst of the throne of the four beasts and in the midst of the elders stood a lamb as it had been slain. That's Jesus. Having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And these seven spirits are the spirit of the Lord, the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of understanding, the spirit of counsel, the spirit of strength, the spirit of knowledge, and the spirit of the fear of the Lord. Now in 1 Corinthians 12:8, by the Holy Spirit we are given 9 spiritual gifts. The word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, faith, healings, miracles, prophecy, discernment, tongues, and interpretation. So there is a broad aspect of the ministry of the Holy Spirit. In Galatians 5:22, it gives us 9 fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, meekness, self-control. Self-control. That are a product of the Holy Spirit that the Bible says is the next thing he wants to give us after forgiveness, remission, and cleansing of sin. Now, these seven spirits of God are basically the Spirit coming and teaching the church. How many could use some wisdom and knowledge and understanding and counsel? Yeah. And see, this doesn't come through human intellect. You can't go to college and get this stuff. The Holy Spirit gives this stuff. The 9 spiritual gifts is the building of the church. Remember, Paul said prophecy is for the edification, the building, the comfort, the inspiration. People come in, they need to grow, and they need to get saved. And these gifts are given to the church so people can grow and be saved. The nine fruits of the Spirit, of course, is your individual character. See, as a Christian individual, you should be partaking, if you've got the Holy Ghost, if you've received that gift, He will start producing these fruits in you. That is the result. And in America, we fight over the baptism of the Holy Ghost when it's a very powerful weapon in God's arsenal. So, what are we going to do with Jesus telling us to repent, believe, confess, be water baptized for the forgiveness, the cleansing, the pardon of sin, and to be filled with the Holy Ghost? What are we going to do with that? We know that sexual immorality is wrong, whether it's homosexuality, sex with children, sex outside the marriage. We know lying and murder is wrong. Stealing is wrong. Dishonoring good parents is wrong. Not loving your neighbor as yourself. How doing harm to yourself, doing harm to your neighbor. We know the Bible says that's the violation of God's word. We know we can be forgiven, cleansed, and delivered through repentance, confessing, water baptism, and believing. We've got to choose today to respond to Jesus above our opinion, our own faith, our own denomination's opinion and faith. We've got to choose today if we're going to be a wimp or a warrior fighting against anti-Bible morality bullies that are trying to change the morality of this nation. We must choose to stand up for our First Amendment right that Congress and the Supreme Court cannot respect any religion or prohibit the free exercise thereof. And it was the Bible and Christianity that they made that decision on. We got to stand up against the violation of the First Amendment when they have respected the religion of secular humanism and atheism and took away the rights of Bible-believing Christians to exercise their faith. This is wrong constitutionally, it is wrong biblically, and we need warriors today that will stand up and say, I'm tired of the anti-Bible bullies, I'm going to stand up for Bible morality, I'm going to stand up for Jesus, and we're going to change the church and we're going to change the nation. So will you ask Jesus for the initial and continual infilling of the Holy Spirit this morning? Will you ask Him for the operation of the nine gifts that built the church, including salvation of sinners, to grow in the nine fruits of the Spirit of character, and allow the seven spirits of God to teach you? Let us pray.